Hi, I'm Dan Clark, and I am the director, writer-director of A Kind of Kidnapping. So this film is it's essentially about a couple who are living in the northeast of England, in their 30s, broke, struggling like a lot of people are, and they hear that a politician from London is going to be in the area, so they decide to kidnap him, but unfortunately no one wants to pay the ransom. And so then they have to try and work out what they're going to do next. So I don't want to give any spoilers, but it's a sort of three-hander chamber piece that sort of plays out in this, you know, in this sort of hostage house. I guess the idea came from, I'd already made a short film about a kidnapping scenario that was very similar, and it seemed to work really well and did really well at the festival circuit. So I was thinking, how can I turn that into something bigger, a feature? And I came across the idea of making the hostage a politician, because I felt like people probably would get off on seeing a politician being kidnapped. They're not very popular these days. And it was a way of me telling someone, like, it's not an overtly political film. Obviously, there is stuff in there, but it was a way of giving it a little bit more depth and some, you know, kind of themes and messaging about not just politics, but like power and how people are also desperate to be recognized and be noticed, whether it's through social media or television or not just politicians, but everybody. Patrick, who plays Richard Hardy, the MP, and Kelly, who plays Maggie, were in the short film version. And it just felt right to continue that. And Jack, we auditioned, and he just had that right quality. You know, he's very good at playing the underdog, but we needed someone that switches in the film, because the character goes through quite a journey where he sort of becomes quite dark towards the end. And he just had that, you know, some actors aren't able to go from two extremes like that. He did it so well. I mean, it is a little bit farcical and a little bit dark. I mean, I used to have a TV show on the BBC called How Not to Live Your Life, which, if people had seen that, it's not the same, but there's elements of that, which is, I like ordinary people in absurd situations, and certainly things that escalate. You know, I've always seen this as a sort of comic tragedy, where we're watching through, we're not really rooting for any one person, we're sort of watching this situation unfold, and you kind of can see that they're going to be like, you know that it's going to end badly, but the fun is, how is it going to end? And it's like a little bit edgy and rude and offbeat in places, and I think the messaging in it is hopefully not too hammered over the head with, like, you know, my opinions or anything.
I'm curious how you feel about the pressures facing the creative industry at the moment, and if you think it is necessary to have some kind of a grassroots reassessment about how the industry is structured and how people are compensated for their work.
I do think it is. You know, it's hard because, you know, there are people who are way more successful asking less successful people to strike for this cause, people that maybe can't afford to strike and they're being asked to do it. And that's a tricky part of it. But I think that the bigger picture is that if people don't put infrastructure in place for writers, actors, and this applies to a lot of industries with the way technology is going, if they don't put the infrastructure in to protect them now, then it might be too late in 5-10 years' time. You know, we may be through the looking glass with AI technology, and not just AI, but like conglomerates, you know, these huge companies that have become so powerful.